learned this song, Irene, from a friend of ours. Some people thought he was the greatest folk singer that ever lived in America.
Good night, Irene. Good night, Irene. I'll see you in my dream.
As a man gone round, taking name.
Led Belly, when I met him, was very ill. And he played for us. His niece was there and she danced for us. And he made me hold his guitar. I said, I can't play the guitar. But he said, well, just hold it and I'll show you some things. And he gave me a lesson on his guitar, on his 12-string guitar. So that was one of my big moments, I guess. And he died not long after that. Martha asked me to sing at his memorial.
On a cloudy morning, first they'll appear and then they're gone.
It was nice. He was a nice man.
Led Belly's friend Woody also played at a memorial concert for him, along with Tom Paley. They had to wait to go on.
He had been going backstage and taking a nip of some drink. So when we actually did get up, he was a bit lit. But he did talk and talk and talk about Lead Belly and about various things. It felt like at least a half hour before we ever got to sing anything.
Dream a dream, dream a dream, dream a dream a little sweeter.
Often Woody didn't turn up at all.
I remember calling his wife. I said, where's Woody? I don't know. He went out on Tuesday to get some cigarettes. He'll probably be back in a couple of weeks. He was one of my heroes, but I got a little bit annoyed at his not showing up for some of the gigs.
It was the Weavers' professionalism and jauntiness that fitted the mood of the time. Folk ranch house style was now commercially viable.
Remember Sweet Betsy from Pike.
I loved Burl Ives recordings. I would glom onto anything that I could get a hold of that sounded like folk music.
A big yaller dog, tall Shanghai rooster, and one spotted hog.
You know, there would be like folk-like songs like Ghost Riders in the Sky and Cry of the Wild Goose and stuff like that. And I liked that music. It told stories.
The tunes the Weavers did became common currency.
Last Saturday night I got married.
The Weavers had the golden touch.
Me and my wife settled down.
Woody Guthrie didn't get an American royalty until the 1950s when the Weavers had taken some of the rough edges off of folk music and popularized it and were singing songs like So Long It's Been Good to
it's
Know
been
You.
Good to know you. So
which was indeed the first hit that Woody Guthrie ever had.
But despite their smart clothes, the Weavers were almost the Almanacs reincarnated. And that past was coming back to haunt them.
I've sung this song, but I'll sing it again of the people I've met and the places I've been.
The Blacklisters were surprised as we were. How did we let those commie so-and-so slip through our fingers?
I'm singing so long, it's been good to know.
And they started chopping us down.
It's been good to know you, so
the world was closing in on the left. In June 1949, the man who was an idol to many in the American folk movement gave a concert in Moscow. Paul Robeson, ex-athlete and lawyer, often sang folk-type songs from Broadway musicals.
Them that plants them is soon forgotten.
His open support for the Soviet Union saw him pilloried at home.
Paul Robeson was under severe attack as a communist traitor and all of that, but he was still our hero and a hero of many thousands and thousands of people.
A little, the radio stations wouldn't play our records, and we became musical pariahs. After about 3 years, we finally had to call it quits. It was a terrible time. I could be walking down Broadway, And I would see someone that I know very well coming towards me. And as they approached, they would cross the street because they couldn't afford to be seen talking to me.
In Kentucky, they said, "You don't have anything to do with Pete Seeger, do you?" And I said, "Yes, he's a friend of mine." And they would look at me kind of strange and walk away.
I want to die easy, Lord, when I die.
Josh White was touring Europe with Eleanor Roosevelt when Red Channels named him.
Lord, when I die.
Josh actually went to the people involved with Red Channels and said, "Look, why are you naming me as a communist? What do I have to do to persuade you that I'm not?" And they suggested that he go voluntarily in front of the House Committee on Un-American Activities.
Pete was saying, "Josh, don't go down there until they call you. Don't romance it. I'm going to do it."
Black entertainers were not asked to name names. Black entertainers were only asked to say that they disagreed with Paul Robeson and that if they had been associated with communist groups, they felt used.
So that's what Josh White did.
My father was attacked from both left and right because of his position.
A land that we call freedom, the home of liberty.
He thought, "All I can do is walk my walk, and maybe somewhere down the line, you will realize, I should see it a little differently."
With its promise for tomorrow, that's America to me.
Josh White was banned from American television for 13 years when the civil rights movement put him back in the limelight. Burl Ives did name names, old friends like Pete Seeger.
Mr. Seeger, you specifically declined the protection of the Fifth Amendment in refusing to answer the committee's questions. Can you tell us why?
In all my life, I've never committed any kind of act, conspiratorial or even conducive. And I resented the implication that by being called before the committee, that because my opinions might be different than Mr. Walters, he has a right to his opinion, I have to mine. Because my opinions might be different than his, that I was any less of an American. And I just feel it's improper for anybody to ask an American citizen his views, whether religious, what church he goes to, how he prays, philosophical, he might be a vegetarian or a nudist or whatever it is. But a man has a right to his own opinion, and I feel that I have to.
There was a young woman who swallowed a lie. I don't know why she swallowed the lie. Perhaps she'll die.
He was to spend the rest of the 50s under investigation. The case wasn't dropped until 1962.
I went around singing at schools and summer camps, and I didn't make much money, but I managed to feed my family. It was almost funny. The John Birch Society would picket my concert at some college, and all they did was give me free publicity and sell more tickets.
Well, I was one of those kids, and I had my Pete Seeger banjo with me, you know, and I was asking him questions, and he had just, he'd just come up with that knock and the door will be open. Pete Seeger was a Johnny Appleseed of folk music. He inspired me to want to do it.
I wish I was a mole in the ground.
But as Pete Seeger was forced underground, an earlier generation of singers was bubbling to the surface, thanks to an unknown record collector with no political agenda for folk music.
There's a mole in the ground, I'd root that mountain down, and I wish I was a mole in the ground.
Most records of the 20s had been pulped for the war effort, but Harry Smith scoured second-hand stalls, picking up the leftovers for a few cents.
It's midnight, and we're walking around in the streets of Harlem, and Harry jumps into a garbage can, head first, jump like this. And he comes up with a stack of photographs. And he starts laying them out on the street in piles and by categories. And people are coming out of the doorways and, "What's going on here?" And Harry then picked them up and handed one to each of the people around. They were all very satisfied. And then we got on the subway and went home.
I used to be a rambler, I stayed around in town. I used to be a rambler, I stayed around in town. I courted pretty Polly, and the beauty's never been found.
Harry put together his own anthology of the best songs by the best artists he found.
In the notes to the record, he had a statement, civilized man thinks out his problems, at least he thinks he does. Primitive man dances them out.
He was a wild genius. That anthology brought that kind of music to a lot of people. And by a lot of people, I mean probably 500 or 1,000. And eventually more and more. It's like dropping a pebble into a still body of water. These rings were felt far and wide.
It would be 10 years before the wave broke over a new generation.
The folk music community at that time was very small, and our apartment was very small, so you could only fit 10 or 20 people in. Woody wasn't performing that much anymore, but people would come around, like Ramblin' Jack Elliott.
I remember once riding in a subway train with Woody, and we were going into Manhattan to get some picks and strings. He's sitting there in the train, and he says, "You know, people around here don't understand our music very well because we sing in a dialect."
But Woody Guthrie was reaching the end of his road. Like his mother before him, he had Huntington's career.
I went out to visit Woody at the hospital. And, you know, he sensed our solicitors. He says, "Hey, you know, you don't have to worry about me here. I mean, this place is fine. If you get up on the street corner and you say, 'Hey, I'm a communist,' you know, they'll stone you, they'll arrest you, they'll do it. Here, I could say, 'I'm a communist,' and they say, 'Oh, he's crazy.' It's the last place in America where you have free speech."